So let me very quickly go through the changes that we have made and the updated FDPs. Each of the two FDPs have been detailed out here. Please, why I'm discussing this is I want you to think about these. I want you to think about these even later. We'll try and get you a printed copy with you so that you can think about it even later. And if you have any suggestions or modifications, we would like to incorporate or learn them and then discuss and incorporate these if possible. Each FDP, as usual, has four modules, roughly to be covered in 1 week per module. But we have said that 1 week of activity, which is about 5 days of activity, so 5 weeks will be given with some intermediate week available. The first module is on information capture, storage, and display, where we'll talk about the subsystem of computer devices for capture. We'll talk about servers, cloud, and storage farms. We'll talk about the effective storage and display, where directory organization, file handling, multiple information formats, organizing and searching information, and commonly used productivity tools such as word processing, spreadsheet, etc., will be covered. By the way, this is something which is now learned by young students in the school itself. In fact, most people will know what browsing is. Most people will know what file system is, how to search files, etc. But you will be surprised that there are many colleague teachers, even today, who are not very comfortable with these technologies. For example, they do not know what should be file naming conventions. And as things go beyond the engineering and technology field, take, for example, library science. You would have some friends who have studied library science. They manage your libraries and other libraries and so on. Extremely well-versed with how to categorize books, classify books, ISBN numbers, etc. But most of these, when they are asked to digitize their content, say, for example, scan a manuscript, scan a book. Okay. So they will scan some paper, and the name of the file will be scan1.jpg. Scan2.jpg. They are asked to prepare a Word document giving all the metadata about some books or something like that and convert that into a PDF file. Invariably, the file name is file1.pdf, file2.pdf. Now, we all laugh at it because we realize the stupidity of using such names. But they are not stupid people. Nobody has told them. Such simple things have to be told, and such simple things have to be practiced. And that is where this module is important. You all agree that this fundamental module will be there? By the way, we'll be using the same module for our vocational training of school children as well. You see, you cannot afford these days to kill one bird by one stone. You have to kill multiple birds by using a single stone. So when we invest in creating any OER, and this is something all of you should remember, it should be primarily targeted for one activity that you have in mind, but it should be reusable in 10 other activities also. Then only your time and effort is worth it. All right. The second module is the world of internet and web. Here, we have reduced the emphasis on networking and connectivity. The fundamental fact that a colleague of mine observed is that in order to drive a car, it is not important to understand how the IC engine works. So accordingly, we have said that while the nomenclature such as protocols, DNS server, etc. can be given, it is not necessary for all of our teachers to understand the nuances, how these things are done. But they must know how exactly they work and how to exploit that. So while we will discuss the basics of connectivity, LANs, WANs, what is an IP address, what is a domain name, we'll describe what browsers are, what plugins are. But the major emphasis will be on usage of these things rather than on how things work. Effective exploration of web, we believe, is a very important aspect which many people are not familiar with. So searching techniques and best practices for exploration. This is something that we are getting some of our best people to give us additional inputs, and we'll create weeks of activities around this time. Online collaboration techniques is something that is still evolving. After all, we are all assembled here, and between today and tomorrow, you will know that our primary objective is also to form collaborating teams. It's not easy to form collaborating teams, and it's not easy to work collaboratively when you are alone at some place and your collaborators are somewhere else. So some mechanism will be explored here. The third module is on evolution and spread of ICT in education. That is where we will talk about content management systems such as Drupal. We'll talk about learning management systems such as Moodle. We'll talk about spoken tutorial methodology. And we will also talk about academic administration that teachers have to do in their own colleges, maintaining marks, giving grades, compiling mark sheets, etc., where different universities, different colleges follow different mechanisms, how they could use technology for that purpose. There was one feedback that I would need from you is, how useful did you find the exercises on WordPress, where you had to design your own web page? Do you think that is useful activity? So we should retain that, right? Because that gives actually teachers a mechanism to create something which they themselves can see whether it is working or not. So it's like hands-on. Is that okay? Fine. We are not very clear on what should be covered in the last module, because the last module is very peculiar to every participating institution. So for example, in IIT Bombay, we have terms like cumulative performance index, computing of grade points, etc. But some other colleges which are affiliated to the university might be awarding marks out of 20 for some internal marks, for example. So how are such records maintained is not very clear to us. After conclusion of this workshop, when you go home, you will find a detailed questionnaire for which you will have to submit a document file giving your opinions on these and other things. Please do spend time at your convenience, but within a week. And as usual, within a week means not the last day of the week. Okay, to give that feedback. Now, this is where we have said using ICT for effective educational communication. For digital content creation and validation, we may use the WordPress kind of activities here again, but with some other tools perhaps. But design of presentation material and visual communication is something in which none of us ever received any formal training. Many of us routinely use PowerPoint slides. So as they say, power corrupts, and PowerPoint corrupts absolutely. And even how to design slides, etc., is not very clear. I think in this FDP also there were some sessions which Dr. Samir Sastrabuddhe conducted. How did you like those sessions? Are they useful? Okay, fine. So we will retain this definitely. How to create handouts and assignments for online usage? Now, online conduct of a quiz is not a very easy thing unless you have a platform. How many of you use Moodle in your own colleges? Oh, fairly large number. Okay, let me reverse this question. How many of you don't use Moodle or any such activity? So that means your assignments, etc., will be paper-based assignments, and they will be assessed on paper. I think you will have to go back and advise your own institutions to change that very quickly, because it means a lot of your time will be wasted in circulating papers, in collecting answer sheets, correcting them, record keeping. This is the traditional way. we'll have to understand that. On emails, we found out we did cover the notion of emails and etiquettes, but not adequately. I think our teachers first and subsequently our students have to be very well educated on how to write anything on net or in social media, for example, and what are netiquettes. So you agree that this should be a useful component of it? And finally, how to use discussion forum and how to use social media in the context of education. So do you think this design now looks better and more comprehensive? Just since you have a printout with you, think about it, reflect on it, and get back if necessary in the,
In the conference last time which we attended, there was a last session on the presentation techniques where they showed different visual techniques as well. You know, where you can write and the same thing can appear on the PowerPoint. And it was really very good, sir, if we could add that as an advanced visual communication technique.
Yes, you can, but you require actually some special tools.
So those which are free, at least we can try to see if we can include them.
Sure.
Yeah.
So what you are saying is that, so just as I am using this Elmo, for example, to write. Now, this tool, how much does this cost again? This, 25,000. So about 25,000 rupees, you can get this gadget. All right. So Sajjan, who is a master in all such devices, we will give him the combined responsibility on all our behalf that he should work that out, and we'll work with some teachers. Professor Gaitonde is an extensive user of that device, I believe. So, and Professor Gadre also. So we'll make them conduct some sessions. It's a very good idea. Where should I add that?
Module 4, second point, sir.
Yeah. So here, what I should say is something like, how would you describe it?
Sir, I think the software name was VideoScribe or something, the one which was shown by the presenter.
What was the name?
I think VideoScribe or something like that. I don't remember right now, but I can recall later because many...
Okay.
Okay.
I'll just put a question mark here.
Okay.
So that I'll remember.
Okay.
Okay, fine. So going forward, if we have a good coverage of these topics, do you think that it will benefit all our teachers? And this would make a good foundation course? While we'll be running these two as separate FDPs, incidentally, admission to the second FDP will require that you qualify in the first FDP. So you cannot come to the pedagogy course and say, who is a file name? That is not permitted. You agree that this should be the sequence in which
actually, when I was passing through this FDP and we were doing our assignments, I felt that there must be some more sessions on Moodle so that we can understand the operation and how to upload everything on Moodle more effectively. So we had to work harder. So for the participants who will be coming for this first FDP, I believe that there must be the session which we'll be designing for Moodle a bit enlarged. Maybe more tutorials and assignments may be there.
More sessions on Moodle. So there is one thinking of the following kind. Why not we facilitate use of Moodle by preparing a Moodle distribution for Indian academic institutions, where you can set up the Moodle. See, technically anyone can download Moodle and install it, but its usage amongst the teachers requires some maturity. In IIT today, there is not a single course which can run without Moodle. In fact, the moment students do online registration for their courses, which is obligatory, but which is done through a different system, a system developed by our application software cell. But the moment they register, that registration automatically goes to the Moodle course. So if I'm teaching a course, every day, every moment, practically, I can know who are the students who have joined, and what is their all basic information, etc. Actually, if you ask me, a separate workshop on Moodle alone is useful. Do you all agree that people will benefit?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
We are showing that we are going to create handouts and assignments. How about plagiarism check regarding the same? The faculty should be aware of regarding the plagiarism check.
Okay. Let me just first write this. Any other point that you would consider for online submissions? This plagiarism check is a very useful point.
Hello.
Yeah.
Last time we interacted with some faculty members of IIT, where they said that Moodle is not that good learning management system. And if we want to develop something in this learning management system, Moodle should be avoided. And we should try some other kind of LMSs which are better for programming and all. And even on internet, when we search for best LMS.
So such as what? Data. Such as what?
LMS. Then teachable, they suggested. So particularly about Moodle, there are problems, people are saying.
Like a Canvas LMS system.
Canvas is also open source?
For teachers, it is.
No. It's a very dangerous game to play. How many of you are familiar with MATLAB? All of you. All of you use MATLAB? All right. How many of you are very sure that in your own institution, all licenses of MATLAB are properly purchased? Much fewer, you see. All. No student copies that MATLAB and goes to the hostel and uses MATLAB. Can you guarantee that?
So I am from Sardar Patel Institute of Technology. We emphasize our student to use Scilab instead of going for MATLAB. Right.
So the point that I am making in the context of this discussion on Moodle, I am happy you raised this issue. We have no problem with commercial products also. I have myself advised large banks to use commercial products such as Oracle, where you require both that kind of performance and that kind of support, which costs money. But I am always worried when a particular software is free for teachers, but not free for general usage. For example, you go through the fine print of such licenses, and you will find that if, let us say, an office superintendent of your department is given a login, that person is not a teacher. Whether that is permitted or not is not known. There are several problems. They are very good. I mentioned MATLAB because it's one of a very good commercial product. Same thing is AutoCAD. AutoCAD provides free license to all academic institutions. But if you have to use something associated with AutoCAD, that costs money. You take word processing tools. This is an older version of Microsoft Word, okay, which is licensed only on this PC. But my staff will use open source tools such as OpenOffice or whatever, whatever. One of the important things for the general spread of technology in this country is that if you take 36,000 colleges, none of them will be able to afford the software cost of a paid product. Now, amongst the open source software that is available, there are multiple choices. IIT Bombay did a lot of thinking on this, by the way, as did many other institutions. Some institutions use the commercial products as learning management systems. So I'll mention two things about it because Software is something I understand, I spent my lifetime on this. There is no package which will ever give you all the features and facilities that you require. Second, in the competitive world, there will always be packages which will give certain facilities better. There is no doubt about it. But what we have to propagate, we should carefully think about and decide. And our parameters are few. Number one, it should be open source so that if necessary, people can make modifications. Please understand that the Moodle that you see today was not the Moodle that it was 10 years ago. You should compare the functionality of the earliest version of Moodle and functionality that is available now. Where do you think this functionality has come from? It has come from people like us who want more functionality. Somebody writes that additional software, somebody releases in that open source. Open source is the best example of collaborating communities, which is something what we want to enlarge. And that is the reason why we have said. Having said that, since some of you seem to be familiar with certain features of LMS which are available either commercially or free for teachers such as Canvas, I would request you to give a feedback on what exactly is the functionality in those packages which you find superior and easier to use so that we can establish teams even in IIT Bombay itself to augment Moodle and send back that modification to the global community. That is entirely doable. So sorry for digression, but I entirely agree that there should be a separate FDP on such things is worthwhile. We'll consider that option also. We have Moodle experts. I think last time it was Professor Bhandarkar conducted some sessions on that, is it? I don't remember who. We had some sessions on Moodle, but you think they are inadequate. There should be more, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Sir?
Yeah.
What is the evaluation criteria for first model? There are two FDPs.
Yeah.
The first FDP, is there any evaluation criteria, like all the pains what we have gone through?
In fact, the evaluation will be our assessment of participating faculty, you are saying.
That's correct.
It will be exactly like what we have undergone.
Yeah.
It will be very similar. So there will be weekly quizzes, an assignment, some peer assessment to be done, some submissions to be done. How much of face-to-face interaction we have to keep, we have to decide. I am of the opinion that after you listen to my colleague's session on AVU, if you find that AVU interaction is good enough, then what we can do is, instead of having the first FDP centered around remote centers, we can make that FDP work from individual workplace of groups of faculty members. And we limit the session interaction with the associate faculty with them. But we in turn will have interaction with the associate faculty. So suppose we have 100 associate faculty. These 100 associate faculty can connect to IIT Bombay, much like an orientation workshop that we conduct for workshop coordinators, where we could routinely connect to each other and get inputs about how the interaction is progressed. Further, we will, since we'll be using IIT Bombay X as the platform, incidentally, we'll not be using Moodle in these FDPs now. And I'll tell you the reason for that. We found that a lot of people were confused between when and what to use Moodle for and when and what to use IIT Bombay X for. So two platforms for the same activity are always confusing. We have decided that we will use IIT Bombay X. We are further augmenting that platform. For the blended mode operation, our modifications are going to be released to the global community in an event in May, the Global Open EDX Conference, where for the first time, India will be contributing back to the global community. But we are also actively considering integrating Moodle with IIT Bombay X. So some features of Moodle could be used. Unfortunately, most of these packages have their own way of creating the base database of all users. And one does not rhyme with the other. So there is a lot of confusion when you switch between two packages, so we'll use that. However, the assessment will be exactly like what you said. And yes, if there are, say, 8,000 participants enrolling for this FDP, it is quite likely that only 5,000 or 6,000 may qualify, independent of personal interact. So participation and qualification are two different things. That is, yeah.
Sir, I request you to conduct one exclusive FDP for us in Moodle.
In Moodle. Okay. So what you are saying is?
An exclusive, a continuation of these two. Before we take this to the next level, some of the participants have told, we might not have explored all the possibilities there.
Okay. So what you are saying is a separate FDP on Moodle for general population is a different thing. But before that,
yeah, for us,
a separate FDP or not
associate
FDP,
faculty.
Only for associate faculty.
Yes, sir.
Interesting. Okay. We'll work that out.
Sir? Yes,
sir. Yeah.
Last time we faced a lot of problem with respect to peer assessment and challenges as well.
Yes.
So the challenges were in terms of rubrics.
You are going to spend 2.5 hours today afternoon facing okay. those challenges once again.
Okay. So sir, there has to be a session for everyone on the peer assessment so that they are very clear about how to do it. And second, the
That will happen in the second.
Okay.
We'll discuss that after the tea break.
Okay. And some alterations in the rubrics are as well as needed.
So that what you are talking about is this FDP 2.
Yes.
We'll come to that later.
Okay.
But any observations on this part?
Good morning, sir. Sir.
Can you raise your hand? Yeah. By the way, whenever you speak, please use that opportunity to tell us your name and the institute you come from.
Sir, I'm Jyoti Shetty from RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. Sir, in our FDP, we were first introduced to licensing, Creative Commons license. I see that is missing here. Creative Commons license, how to use, I mean, whenever we use the resources, we should be seeing the license first before we use.
So you are suggesting something like this should be added?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes. And in the module 1, so we use Google Forms nowadays to capture the information and from the students and all. So that should also be part of the module 1, Google Forms, to take a survey.
Is that the way to put it? Tools to conduct surveys and polls?
In fact, Google Forms, they are open source and
okay. All of us use Google Forms. So what are the problems with Google Forms? No, that is not true. What she's saying is anybody can change anything. That is not true. Google Forms has variety of mechanisms to safeguard the data. In fact, it has become one of the most popular collaborative tools. Sorry, you're saying
something. Sir, I am Saurabh Maru from GSITS Indore. Sir, last year when we did FDP, there was a WordPress and we created a web page. So after 1 year, shouldn't we shift or shouldn't we aid creation of apps also, because it is also available free of cost in a way like WordPress, so it will be more personalized messages, like content can be communicated. And there is number of apps which are available free of cost.
Yes.
For content like, I am a pharmacy faculty, so like heart and many disease related that we are already utilizing and proven to be very useful.
I will possibly put it so, should I say world of apps or applications? Please understand that you can practically run a semester course on every line of these contents. Now, the trick is to decide what is most appropriate as a general introduction and general awareness. That is what we are creating. So I think taking a cue from this desire, perhaps the content should be such that for those who are interested, we should give pointers and additional material for them to study, see and so on. But we missed out the first question that I asked. What is the problem with Google Forms, if any? Anybody? Yeah.
Sir, I'm Prafulla from RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. To whatever my friend just now told, Jyoti Shetty, like Google Forms you're asking, evaluation is very difficult with Google Forms. So if we can come up with some interface by taking the survey or whatever we do.
Can you elaborate on what do you mean by evaluation?
Evaluation like exactly the metrics, whatever you have done in Moodle using that platform, if we can integrate or have an interface.
No, there are two different things that we are talking about. When you talk about assessment, you are talking about individual submissions and those submissions to be assessed.
Yes.
Whereas Google Form is talked about more in the context of a collaborative platform where I can insert information in a row about myself, my preferred timing, my preferred topic, which has nothing to do with assessment. It is merely a mechanism of collecting a whole lot of information from large number of people. And particularly for polls and all, Google Forms can be used very effectively. But nobody pointed out any problem with Google Forms. So let me tell you, this is not a,
Good morning, sir. I'm Nilesh Sabnis from Sanjay Godawat Institute, Kolhapur. I face one problem regarding with the Google Form is that we cannot attach files. If we want to take some submissions in form that, we cannot attach any file.
Okay. So Google Forms are definitely not meant for collecting submissions. Google Forms are meant for collecting basic information. So it's just like a Google spreadsheet or an ordinary spreadsheet where you can collect information. Typically, the way it is used is that every participating person is supposed to edit one row of that form. In that row, you put whatever information relevant to you, and the columns are pre-decided, or there are certain columns which you may choose. So functionally, that is the limited objective itself for Google. So don't expect it to do anything more than that. But I am not talking about a functional problem at all. Yeah.
Sir, I am from Sardar Patel Institute of Technology. My name is Deepak Karya. Normally, we take a mid-sem feedback via Google form, and we expect the students to fill the form by a particular period of time. But what do I see is that not all the students are compulsorily doing it. So we don't get a response from, say for example, it's a class of 70 students. So normally I get a response 30 to 40. So it's like I have to shut down the window after that period waiting for a good amount of time. So this is a major problem which I feel that we don't get all the responses.
IIT Bombay has solved that problem very simply. The online feedback by students is compulsory. If any student who does not fill up the online feedback for every course, the grade is not declared for that student. So we are very clear, the online feedback is not made available to the teacher unless the teacher has submitted the grades. So that there is no possibility of my having a khunnas. Achha, mere ko aisa bolta hai, abhi fail grade diya, aisa nahi kar. I mean, nobody does that, but it's a precaution. And similarly, the grade is not given to the student unless student has given the feedback. So these mechanisms, by the way, they're slightly different thing but important. How many of your institutions compulsorily require students' feedback for every course that you teach? Very large number. Is that because of the national ranking framework requiring it to be mandatory? So you see, all of us benefit from an external audit. Somebody says, I'll give you marks for this, then you start doing that act. Fair enough. All right.
Sir.
Yeah.
I'm Sridharan from Adi College of Engineering, Bangalore.
Yeah.
Actually, app-based learning we are implementing today. So students are using Quick Learn. We introduced an app in our department called Quick Learn. So we are inputting the notes and other things in the app, Android app. So that students are telling it is more useful. Why can't IIT Bombay can do an app for the all the people who are using this as a platform, so that all the inputs can be given and we'll train in a very good manner, so that update can be given in the app. So that could be a good idea for the future applications as well as teaching learning methodologies.
Yeah.
Your comments on that, please.
We will definitely consider using apps. The fact of life is that many of our teachers are not very comfortable in dealing with smaller devices as educational devices. A mobile, many teachers don't feel that it's a utility as an access device. Okay. The apps that we talk of don't work on desktops. They are meant to work on small devices or mobile devices. Now this spread itself will happen. For an FDP of this kind, where we have to talk about many more things, perhaps it is useful to say that apps are important, social media is relevant, developing and using apps is critical, and we give one or two examples. Please understand, the purpose of this FDP is to improve teaching learning process and its understanding by our teachers. There are a whole lot of details, as I said, practically on every line of these contents, we can design a semester-long course. So we have to decide to what extent to enlarge something and to what extent to compress something. It's not going to be an easy choice. Notice that this is different from what we had originally announced. This is based on some feedback. Today we are getting more feedback. We'll be modifying it. Please understand that we cannot stuff so much material that participant will find it impossible to do in that 5 days of online activity. Because there is a limited time that a participant can spend. So I appreciate your point, but what we'll do is, we'll only emphasize saying how the use of apps is critical and important, and we'll leave it at that.
Yes. Sorry. Sir, this is Sharma from Jyoti Institute of Technology, Bangalore.
Yeah.
Coming back to the question, is it multiple submissions?
For?
Google form. We can have multiple submissions for the same questionnaire.
Again, that is not the primary objective of a Google form. But as far as conducting polls is concerned, as far as conducting feedback is concerned, and as far as doing a collaborative documentation is concerned, Google forms are very good. But that is not the problem that I was mentioning.
Sir, my name is Hari Mohan Rai from Krishna Engineering College, Ghaziabad, myself.
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, I found that most drawback of the Google form is the result can be manipulated, because whatever the polls and survey we are saving it out, it will be in the form of sheet, like Excel sheets. So there, I mean, the data, it can be saved in the form of Excel sheets, can be manipulated, can be, you know, can be changed, can be modified like that.
By no means Google form is expected to be a safe mechanism. It is not meant for that. It's a collaborative tool. In any collaborative tool, sanctity of the final result is based on the willingness of each individual collaborator. Any one of the collaborators decides to wash out your entire Google form, he or she can scrub it in 5 minutes. You don't need any external person to manipulate. So do learn to distinguish between collaborating tools or collaborative tools and safe tools. For example, if you use Moodle, Moodle is open source, but the Moodle installation in your institution will be controlled by the system administrators and some faculty members. So there, nobody, including the teacher, can manipulate something after something has been frozen. So distinguish between the safe system, such as a banking transaction system or airlines reservation system. These are safe systems which are designed differently. Google Form is not designed like that. But since there is a very limited time for a tea break, let me share with you the concern that Google Form and such tools universally have. Any other observation? I think there's
someone. Hello, sir. Yeah. I'm from KIT's College of Engineering, Professor Saurabh Joshi.
Right.
Sir, last 5 years, we are using Moodle in our college, and we are getting like we are adding quiz, even submission, then videos,
yes,
grading, and automatically graded has been done.
Yes.
And even any user cannot do any manipulation in that.
Yeah, yeah.
Only a person or a faculty member can do everything. Even we are keeping quiz opening date, quiz closing date, and automatically grading comes. Instead of using Google Forms or Excel sheet for continuous assessment report or sheet, we
so
can do it
the only
collaboratively.
Teachers have, or in our case, teaching assistants also have the access.
Okay.
It depends. You can define the access control and so on. But you see, Moodle is a safe application.
Yes.
It is designed for that safety. Google Form is not designed for that.
Yes, sir.
Right.
So it can be overcome by using Moodle. Google Form. Absolutely.
No. It cannot be overcome by using Moodle. I will tell you one simple distinction. In Moodle, unless a course has been created and unless I am enrolled in that course, either as a teacher or as a student, I cannot participate in that.
Yes.
Suppose in my department, I want to quickly conduct a poll amongst all my faculty and students and staff, saying how many of you are interested in going to a picnic and which of the 2 days you would prefer for this picnic. Now I can send this mail to all my students, all my faculty colleagues, and all my department staff. But none of them are a common component of any one course on my Moodle. So how will they participate?
Sir, there is a discussion forum in Moodle. There is a one discussion
the
forum.
Discussion forum cannot be commented upon by any arbitrary soul. You have to be a member of that community to participate in that discussion forum. The Google Form is not meant for that. Google Form is meant for open collaboration.
Everyone.
I can invite any Tom, Dick and Harry to join. So consider, for example, I want to have survey conducted out of some 100 participants of the FDP, okay, who are doing the first FDP, but who are interested in, let us say, contributing a specific open educational resource content created in thermodynamics of mechanical engineering department. How will I access people? There are 4,000 participants. So I must make something which is easily accessible to them. If there are 4,000 participants of my Moodle course or IIT Bombay X course, I can use the poll that you want. But if I want to say anybody in India, how will I do it? So these two different objectives are there. There's one more observation of friend.
Sir, myself, Dr. Praveen from Gokaraju Rangaraju Institute of Engineering and Technology, Hyderabad. Sir, what I feel is since this group, they are all excellently performed people. So one request is, can some of us can maybe like either guide or either can pursue PhD in educational technology? Because as you say, your vision is to train 1 crore people. So
yes.
It should be a continuous R&D. And another problem is if some of us, those who don't have PhDs, want to do PhDs, and whether technical AICT apex body, can they consider this as a technical PhD? So because tomorrow AICT chairman is coming. So because lot of people don't recognize our work if we work in ICT, etc. So how we can really deal about this thing?
We are all slaves of the stamps that we put on our backs. So we have to be either mechanical engineer or electrical engineer. Have you ever heard of someone applying to for a faculty position and says, I am an engineer. Which department I should apply for? Which position I should apply for? Similarly, at the PhD level, stupidly this country says, your PhD must be in this area. Otherwise, you cannot be appointed as a faculty member. In the IIT system, at least PhD is never given in a department. It is given on the title of the thesis. So your PhD is on that thesis. But whatever, you are right, even here, we have these silos. I don't know how to destroy those silos. I've been struggling for last 30 years. I'll continue to do so till rest of my life, but it's not going to be very easy. So, answering your question, I've invited Professor Sridhar Iyer, who has taken over recently as head of our Center for Distance Engineering Education Program, and he is now the convener of our interdisciplinary academic program on education technology. One of the things that he and Prasanna Murthy have been doing for almost a decade now is to emphasize the importance of research in ET and research in education. Jay Krishnan, who is just finishing his PhD, is going to have a session with you. I will request both Professor Sridhar Iyer and Jay Krishnan to talk about how we could encourage research in ET as a part of this association itself, and in fact as a part of these FDPs in future. That's a very good point. We'll do that. Yeah.
Hello. I'm myself Dr. C.R. Patil from a pharmacy organization from Shirpur, Dhulia. Actually, sir, we are considering regarding the foundation program in for 2 weeks program, FDP. So what I feel is, if engineers are there who have already gone through such courses, then they only will be able to handle all these contents within 2 weeks. For a fresher, even these contents will be quite heavy.
These contents?
Will be too much, like understanding Moodle, understanding apps, everything they cannot do within 2 weeks. Because when we did it in beginning, even going through Moodle was quite difficult for us. So what I feel is, even this content should be reduced, or there should be 3 FDPs instead of 2. And then the content should be accommodated.
In fact, this is the argument that I was having sometime earlier. I think these are some very sober thoughts, and all of us should pay attention to it. Remember what I said, every one of us has limited time, only 24 hours in a day. If I'm a faculty member at some place, and if you are conducting this FDP, you expect me to work equivalent of one day in a week, that is 8 hours of work. I think you have to sit down and try to put yourself into my shoes and try to understand how much work can I do in those 8 hours in a week. And if you take one module, there are 4 points on that module. Every point I have to not only read, view some lectures, do some exercise, understand and assimilate in 2 hours' time. Before you prescribe what others should do, you should yourself judge whether that is doable in that given time or not. And that is why our desire to extend apps, extend this, etc., is very good and very nice. But we should, these the thoughts expressed by our friend here are very sobering thoughts. We must keep that in mind. Secondly, we're not designing these FDP for 253 top performers anywhere. We are just like when we teach a course to 100 students, while we do want the top performing students to do very well and learn more, we also want to ensure that the bottom performer in my class also learns a minimal thing, so that when that student passes, we know and the world knows that these minimum skills and understanding is there. I think that is our job. So thank you very much for pointing this out. Who mentioned that? I forgot the name. What's your name once again?
So this is Dr. C.R. Patil.
C.R. Patil, okay. So this is an important point, and you notice that every time you gave a feedback, I was adding lines or clauses there. So these clauses are not necessarily going to be all accepted. They will be assessed on the basis whether an ordinary participant, an ordinary mortal amongst us, desiring to learn something new but has limited time, whether I can assimilate and do justice in 2 hours for a particular line in that module or not. If I cannot, I must reduce the content. Because it should also be feasible. There's no point in saying this is the work that you have to do and nobody is able to do that. All right.
Good morning, sir. This is Dr. Jagpal from Ackman Institute of Management, Greater Noida, UP. I have been using all the Web 2.0 technologies platform from last many years. That includes WordPress, Padlet, Wikispaces, Moodles, Moodle Cloud, and including Google Forms. I found Google Forms are not for sharing and for other things. But Padlet I have been using. Almost every course I undertake, I use a Padlet, create a Padlet for my students. In that, I can share them what I'm supposed to share with them.
Yeah.
But Padlet also can be used with other faculty members, maybe from different departments, maybe from different organizations. But Padlet has a problem. The problem is again with the license. For academics, it is allowing for academics as a free, but I want to know what could be consequences in that case if it is not true in that sense.
Yes. So consequences of licensing, I already mentioned that if something is open source, we'll do that. Google Forms, by the way, is certainly not an open source tool. Okay. There's no license involved, they give it free, but they give their utilities free for a completely different reason. They use the data that goes onto those Google Forms. And we must break for tea now, but after coming back, I'll tell you in the pedagogy session on what are the possible dangers for sharing such data later. So we'll come back at 11:30.